Good morning. Would y'all please stand for our gathering song this morning? And if you can see on the screen, or it's in our chalice hymnal number 272. Bulletin in there. There's a slip on the side for those of you that are visiting. If you'd fill that out, if you have any changes in address, phone number, or prayer requests, please fill that out and put it in the offering plate as it comes by. Let's look at our announcements today. There's quite a few, and I may have to ask some of you some questions here in a minute because it's not complete. We'll start with the Bible study at noon every Wednesday. Oops, this week will be on 17th. Today we have our fellowship potluck lunch. Did you have something to say on that?
No.
Okay.
We will have no funeral planned.
So far. Yeah. I hope that doesn't happen. Anyway, fellowship potluck lunch today, and that's for the elders and deacons' roles in the church. It's a training, but we're also asking any new members that have joined that it's good training for you as well. If you're interested in being an elder or deacon, it'll be good training as well. We're going to eat next door as soon as we're finished here at noon, and it should start at 12:30 and end at 2 o'clock. That's with Dr. Don Weeks of the Connection Christian Church. Right. Okay, the worship committee will meet on August the 13th at 11 a.m., unless that's changed. We still good on that?
It took place. I wasn't here for
it. Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't mark that out.
You weren't here either?
You need to reschedule
it? Y'all forgot? Well, good, because I couldn't be here.
Okay. Good. All right, August the 20th. We have the Christian Women's Fellowship Brunch kickoff and restart at 10 a.m. at Bethany. Whoever's in charge of that, would y'all like to expound on that and let the new ladies know what kind of this is about? Who's in charge of the program? No one? Who called it up?
It just happens.
Yes. But can you tell us about what Christian Women's Fellowship does? What's the purpose?
Mission support.
Okay. All right. We don't have any information on the stewardship committee. I guess this is a monthly meeting at 1 o'clock. We don't have the date set for that one yet. The board meeting will be, is that the second Sunday of September? I don't have a date, but it's the second.
It's going to be next Sunday.
In August? Okay. Okay, so the September board meeting will be next week on the
This is the August one because it's supposed to be today, but because of the elder deacon training.
Okay. Okay, so there will be another one coming in September. Got it. Okay, and then we have some joyful news. Dawn and Lynn, your wedding is September the 18th, and there's no time. What time?
2:30.
We'll be sure. Got it.
Plenty of time to pray about it.
Okay. September the 25th, we will be having our fellowship luncheon, the birthday. Is that the birthday? Yes, 65th birthday. There'll be more to come on that. And Tuesday, October the 4th, we're having on our national night out, Meet the Neighborhood, and OPD, ECSD, and Emergency Services. And there'll be more information on that, I'm assuming, coming too, right? You don't have a time or anything yet?
No, I could have told you if you wouldn't have.
Well, you can let us know. That's not till October. We got a ways out. Okay. And Christy asked me to announce that she is, if you are in possession of any church keys, you need to get with her so she can make sure you have the new code. That will be changing as of today, and you won't be able to get in, and the police will show up. So if you have a key to the church, any part of the church, get with Christy before you leave today, and she'll assign you your own personal code to get in and out, correct? Okay. All right. Any other announcements? Do you have anything? Anybody else have any other announcements I may have missed? All right. She's changing the code.
No, not the code. The meeting that's going to be this month instead of
the board meeting is going to be August the 21st. It was supposed to have been today, but we're not going to run into that since we have the training. So we'll have it on the 21st at 5 instead. All right, we have another song. Please join us in singing our call to worship, Promised Land by Toby Mack.
Success doesn't have to mean getting the corner office. It isn't always climbing the corporate ladder.
I just got my first sale.
We got it!
It isn't...
Commercial for
Head down as I punch this clock. The hours roll, they never stop. And I can't ever seem to get ahead. Always trying to do what's right. Straight and narrow's getting tight. Don't know how much longer I can stand. And I'm wondering, yeah, I'm wondering, where's my promised land? Out here on this desert road, it's hot as fire, but I've grown cold. Circling like a plane that never lands. And even though the questions change, the answers always stay the same. Maybe someday I will understand. So I'm wondering, got me wondering, where's my promised land? Yeah, I'm wondering, still I'm wondering, where's my promised land? Well, I've run this earth for many years. If there's one thing I know, there's nowhere on this side of heaven where streets are made of gold. I've long laid down my grand illusions, looking toward the day that I'll be home. I won't give up on this race, broken but I still have faith that this old life is all part of a plan. And I can feel it in my soul, one day I'll stand before the throne with nothing left but hope in these two hands. Through all these seasons, I'm still believing you're my promised land. In all my grieving, I'm still believing you're my promised land.
Follow along in the responsive reading with me. May Christ dwell in your hearts through faith as you are being rooted and grounded in love.
May you have the power to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge.
Now to the one who is able to accomplish far more than all we can ask or imagine.
To God be the glory in the church and in Christ Jesus to all generations forever and ever.
Let us worship God. Please pray. Father, your acts are amazing, Lord. We cannot comprehend the number of blessings you pour out on us from day to day. As we gather today around your name, we pray that you would fill our hearts and our minds and souls. Transform us, Lord, and make us more like you. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
All right. Will the children come up for the children's moment?
Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong, they are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me. Bible
First, I want y'all to raise your hands. We'll talk. Raise your hands. We'll talk. Can you do that? Take a deep breath. Deep breath. Now go down like this. Bend. Can you bend like this? You have to stand up. Bend like that. Now, Addie, how would you like to stay just like that all day?
Whoa.
Huh? Would it be hard?
Oh.
Christy, thank you for the good job that you do, and also the worship committee in planning our worship services. We appreciate that very much also. As we come to a time of prayer, there are many that we want to remember in prayer. We've got a couple that are back that we've been praying for, and that both Gail Kinney has been out for a little while. Connie Phillips has been out, but they're both back, still dealing with those issues that all of us have. So we're glad that God is helping them. Molly is here with her family, and Molly's going to finally get some things done in that move. Slowly, isn't it? Slowly but surely. It's like dealing with the mafia when you're buying a new house and selling one. It is. It feels like that. I know. There's always another charge. We forgot to tell you there is another charge for this. So play for them as that takes place. Claire is here. Glad to see you, Claire, and his family. Glad that they're here. Rita and Carol, I heard about them. It was a busy week, and I didn't get a chance. Kept saying I was going to call them and never did get a chance to, but I did hear from Don today that Rita is cancer-free. She's going to be doing some preventative therapy still, but then I understand that she is cancer-free, and so I'm looking forward to praising God with them with that decision that's been made. She's had such difficulty with it. Mandy Rhodes, continue to remember her in prayer as she continues her journey. People of the Ukraine, of course. Brad Blake, any report that you'd like to share with us? Yeah. I'll get to see them again here very soon, and I hope to see everybody when I get to see them. But I appreciate his family caring for him. For Bonnie Brown family, I mentioned that Bonnie had died, and her family still thanks you for their prayers and also for prayers for them as they continue to grieve. Don shared with me about Jerry Riggs, one of his family who is on hospice now, and we ask that God might help them, bless that family and help them. And an uncle, it was a special person to Don. Our cousin, isn't it? Cousin is a special person to Don. Levi Brewer was mentioned to him in prayer. We want to remember a two-year-old who is dealing with severe brain damage from shaken baby syndrome. So we want to ask God's comfort and help upon him and also his family. The Parrish family, some good friends of mine, they are racers. Their children have always been involved in racing. And one child is now involved in, he's an adult now, but he's involved in larger car racing. But the younger son, Christopher, is raced four-wheelers, but he did have an accident. They were down in Denver. They live in the Dallas area, and she was up in Minnesota with the other child watching a race, and her father was down with the younger one in Denver, but he had a wreck, and he's been on a respirator for the last couple of days, and they're planning to take him off the respirator tonight. He had a lot of severe injuries from his wreck. So Christopher Parrish, remember Christopher? Yeah, he was in a terrible wreck, and I had several broken ribs and some other broken bones and some lung damage, and they were hoping that through the respirator they might be able to get the respirator off today. So pray for them. Deborah did fly from Minnesota down to Denver, and she's family's all together now there. So please remember them in prayer. Something they've lived with. They've had all kinds of accidents through the years, but this is the most severe little Christopher has ever had. So who else do you want to remember in prayer? In the fire, Yeah, I have had several prayer requests this morning on my phone about her. Yeah, that's very tragic. The fire, the rest of the family got out, but the little 11-year-old did not. He was burned to death. Thank you for that. You'll remember our fellowship dinner today and pray for each other. We'll have a great fellowship dinner. Everybody's invited. There's plenty of food, so come and join us for lunch right after church. And our last prayer will be the prayer for our meal. And then we'll have immediately after that, we will have that training will take place. It's going to be good. That I think first our Connection Christian Church is going to have several people here as well. Several of their elders are going to be here, do the training all at once. I appreciate Don doing that training for us. And I will mention that, since I mentioned Don, I think she may be on our team. I'd recommended her for a team, an Emmaus team. A women's walk to Emmaus is coming up the very end of August, going into the 1st of September. If you're interested, talk to me and I'll get you an application. Walk to Emmaus, if you've never heard of it, you can ask me about it and I'll share that with you. But there's a walk coming, and it's going to be the first women's walk that we've had in a long while since COVID. So we want to pray and ask God's blessing upon it as it takes place. Thank you for your prayers at Presbytery. That was what made my week so busy, is that Presbytery, the Presbytery del Cristo, which I'm still a part of through the Presbyterian Church, I'm required to attend, as you probably know for other ministers that you've known. I'm required. And then they made the rules even stricter. Man, I'm getting tired of rules. Is this just here lately? Rules are just running out my ears. Because I am so tired of rules. Rules are changing. They decided to change the rules for attendance, and they've made it more severe. Now, they wanted, in fact, I think we dismissed, took away their ordination of four ministers. The day, main presbytery. I voted against it. They don't listen to me. They're used to me saying no a lot. I'm the only one. No! That's just Jimmy. He's a no guy. Messed up. He don't like rules. I don't like rules. So thank you, though. The presbytery went well. And they are making, a lot of pastors have left the churches or have a variety of different problems with COVID, as all denominations have had. So please remember the Presbytery del Cristo. We go all from here all the way to California. A lot of Chinese were here in town for the presbytery. We have a lot of Chinese churches out in California. So the downtown church in Chinatown is a Cumberland Presbyterian church. It's a neat church. And I happened to mention, so I'm going to mention it now because you can join with me. Visiting that church, I saw a window. I love stained glass. Some of you know about that. I just really enjoy taking pictures of stained glass. And so I was going around San Francisco because I'd never been there before and taking some pictures of stained glass, since downtown church was downtown Chinatown. And in that church, there was this beautiful stained glass, and I went in to take a picture of it, and I couldn't believe that it existed. It's an enormous piece of stained glass, about as big as the doorway back there as we go out, and it says, Texas. Texas. Across it. Yeah. And ended up that a church, the first Cumberland Church of Lubbock, decided they needed a piece of stained glass, and they sent it on a train back in the early 1900s. Sent the piece of glass to that church, and the Chinese couldn't give up the gift, you know, because of losing face, and so they put it in. And so it's still there, and their front glass is Texas. Love that. All right, we better pray. I'll digress more. Lord Jesus, we sure do love you, and we thank you for the way in which you have blessed us and helped us in the ways that only we know about and only you know about, Lord. You and your personal walk with us. So help us to relish in that prayers answered, as well as those prayers that aren't answered, Lord Jesus, because you have reasonings and all that you do. We pray and intercede for these special ones that we brought before you now. And corporate prayer is such a special thing for us to mention in prayer, the number of people that we have in our prayer list. We ask humbly your blessing upon them, that you might move in us, work in us, and help us to love and to care and to reflect your glory to them, Lord Jesus, as we have opportunity. Bless our worship as we continue to worship, Lord Jesus, and help us. We love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's sing as we prepare for communion. Thank you.
this very room, there's quite enough love for one like me. And in this very room, there's quite enough joy for one like me. And there's quite enough hope and quite enough power to chase away any gloom. For Jesus, Lord Jesus, is in this very room. And in this very room, there's quite enough love every room, there's quite enough joy for all of us, and there's quite enough hope, yes, there's quite enough hope to chase away any gloom. For Jesus, Lord Jesus,
together in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you. in drink. Stand together for the doxology. You may be seated. So we continue to talk about those last words of Jesus on the cross, as well as the words included in the Lord's Prayer. Jesus said, "I thirst," from the cross, assuring us of his humanity. And then in the Lord's Prayer, he says, "Deliver us from evil," the eternal deliverance of God. In fact, both passages are reflections of the human meeting the eternal, our humanity meeting the eternity of God. In Jesus saying, "I thirst," he was not only human, but also divine there on the cross, and then also in the sermon in the Lord's Prayer, he said, "Deliver us from evil." An idea that even in God's presence and glorifying God, we are God's children, but still need his deliverance from the evil that tempts us. From Jeremiah, the 9th chapter, this is what the Lord says, verse 23. "Let not the wise man boast in his wisdom, or the strong man boast in his strength, or the rich man boast in his riches. But let him who boasts about this, that he understands and knows me, I am the Lord, who exercises kindness, justice, and righteousness on earth. For in these I delight, declares the Lord." We're human. We don't glory in wisdom and in might and in riches, and there is a temptation for us to do so. Doesn't matter who you are, those things still come into play, and we have to remind ourselves not to let them come into play. For example, at Presbytery, I already mentioned, there was a tendency for us to recognize and to remember and to make rules to accommodate those that we are most familiar with, the people we're most familiar with. Here they were making a lot of rules yesterday. Y'all don't mind me griping about Presbyterians, do you? Here they were griping about the rules, and at the same time, griping that we weren't obeying the rules. At the same time, they broke the rules because certain people wanted to talk and were out of order. And all I could do is just shake my head. You know, you are being so two-faced. You know, and you shouldn't, you know, we all are that way. We all are sinners, but please not, don't do it so publicly. Be two-faced. Now, we need to follow the rules, but we're going to break the rules for my friend over here. No, we're not going to do that.
nor reminded me of one of the Presbytery meetings that I went to. It was one of the first ones I ever went to. And the pastor at First Cumberland in Lubbock was a good friend of mine. And he was a different kind of pastor, wore an earring and rode a motorcycle. They didn't let him stay very long, you know, because First Presbyterian in First Cumberland in Lubbock is a more formal-like church. They have a very formal church. I helped install this new pastor, and he wears a clerical collar even. You know, he's very formal about things. Well, this particular pastor was at a meeting, and it was there at his church. And the moderator for our presbytery, he got up, and he was an older pastor who had been there for a long time, been in the same church for 30 years. Over in Albuquerque, he is now deceased, but he became a good friend also through the years. He didn't like me at first because I had that Baptist background, and he didn't like that, but he eventually calmed down and realized I wasn't so Baptist, and he accepted me. But he said, you know, my committee, the missions committee, we are working with a church down in near Mexico, and you know what? We have found $20,000 in an account that we had forgot we had. The presbytery has $20,000. They found it in an account, and he said, you know, that is such an answer to prayer because my missions committee needs that money for the project that we're doing. And of course, this pastor from Lubbock, he stuck his hand up and he said, yes. And he goes, my committee is the pastor assistance committee, and we need that money too. Whose prayer did God answer? Well, obviously, the guy who was the moderator, he got the money because they decided the other pastor was just being facetious, but he was making a good point. We're human, but we don't glory in wisdom, might, or riches, but we glory in knowing him, his righteousness. That's what we glory in, and we should. It should be priority. Doesn't mean that God's not concerned about how we make a living, that God's not concerned about making our house bill or paying our electric bill. Ooh, wasn't it big this time? Wow, electric bills were high this last time. Nor is he ignorant of or not concerned with our church budget. He is concerned about those things, but knowing him and his righteousness is what comes first, and making sure that that is a priority for us. Ephesians emphasizes that again in the sixth chapter, in these few verses. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armor of God, so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground, and after you have done everything, to stand. Stand firm then, with the belt of truth buckled around your waist, with the breastplate of righteousness in place, and with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. In addition to all this, take up the shield of faith, with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation, the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God, and pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the saints. The righteousness of God that delivers us is the glory of his armor, and his armor is on you. God doesn't need the armor. The armor of God is his presence, is his person, is his character, his glory, that is already purely his. But we need the glory of God reflected in us in the armor of the Spirit, the armor of his righteousness. And that armor, we are able not only to withstand the temptations of the world, but also put in priority all those things that give us instruction about how we should live. From Ephesians 1, just a few verses, verse 17. I keep asking that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the glorious Father, may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation so that you may know him better. I pray also that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope to which he has called you, the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints and in his incomparably great power for us who believe. That power is like the working of his mighty strength,
which he exerts in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly realms, far above all rule and authority, power and dominion, and every title that can be given, not only in the present age, but also in the one to come. God placed all things under his feet and appointed him to be the head over everything for the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills everything in every way. May God give us that spirit of wisdom. Paul prays in the book of Ephesians, and he prays it also along with us in the days that we live in today. Revelation of knowledge of him, knowing the riches of his glory, being like him. May God grant us the wisdom to be able to be like him, as only he can do for us. There is another passage that I want to read out of the book of Galatians. Galatians chapter 6, and again, just a few verses. Verse 14 is where I'll begin, out of the 6th chapter. May I never boast except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, through which the world has been crucified to me and out of the world. Neither circumcision nor uncircumcision means anything. What counts is a new creation. Peace and mercy to all who follow this rule, even to the Israel of God. Finally, let no one cause me trouble, for I hear that on my body, for I bear on my body the marks of the Lord Jesus. If I can glory, you and I can glory in anything. Let us glory in reflecting Christ by being crucified with Christ to the world, becoming that new creature that he has designed for us to become. I bear on my body, Paul says here, the marks of the Lord Jesus. We reflect his glory by balancing our humanity and that heavenly spirit inside of us. I've heard two phrases, and you have two, over the course of my life, and those are too many phrases, but these two phrases often parallel one another. Someone will say, you know, Jimmy, you are just too earthly to be of any heavenly good. Or someone will say, you know, Jimmy, you are so heavenly minded that you're of no earthly good. I've seen them both reflected. Saw that latter one reflected when I would go and try to help somebody do construction. They would say, well, what do you do for a living? I'm a preacher. So they let me paint the closets. I really did. I painted the closets or paneled the closets. Or why don't you go down to the river? I always wondered how that was going to end. And they said, and get some rock for us to use and cement it. Those are the things that let preachers do, because they knew that I was of no earthly good in most things. I was too heavenly minded, they decided. What we are to be is we are to be heavenly minded, but that heavenly mindedness is to reflect him. We are physical, and in this world we have things that we can do, but at the same time, that which is spiritual should be above the other. Physical things that we do are important, but that spirituality should be above the other. There should always be an offering of grace. Such as the meeting yesterday. Can't get away from that, can I? No, I can't. Or on Friday. When they decided, now, you have to understand the history of this. I used to be the chairman of the Care of Ministers Committee. And I took great care of calling the ministers, finding out how they're doing, and helping them. And they kept on my back. I was that Care of Ministers chairman for like 6 years. And they stayed on my back. They said, you know, Jimmy, the ministers are to report an excuse on why they're not at the meetings. And it has to be sent within a week of our meeting. And we have not heard from several of our ministers. And do you know what the problem is? And I said, no, I don't. I don't know what the problem is. For many of them, they are uncontactable. Their emails and their addresses don't work. I'm not sure where they're at. I hear about them every once in a while, and now and then, one shows up that they had been sick or that they had been in an area and ministering in an area that nobody knew about. Well, you know what? If they're not here, we just need to take their ordination away from them and oust them out of the presbytery. And I refused to do it. So for 6 years, it didn't happen, because they would say, now, Jimmy, you need to do your job, and that means for you to police these ministers. And I said, you know what? That's not my job. My job is to find out how they're doing and to bless them and to pray for them and to encourage them. And I said, you know what? We shouldn't trash people. And these ministers, I don't know where they are. Some of them are, and I don't know what they're doing. God knows. And I said, what hurt is it for them to stay on the list, even if they don't hear? So they broke the rules.
Let's just leave them on the list, and eventually, sometime things happen. I said, haven't you had that happen in your life before? Haven't you been looking for an old uncle or an old friend or maybe looking for somebody that you hadn't seen in a long time, and suddenly you find them? I buried a guy yesterday. He and his wife had been married for 12 years. But he had dated her when he was in high school, and when he got drafted to Vietnam, he asked her to marry him, and she said, no, let's wait till you get back. He got back, and they did not see each other for 40 years. But he looked for her for 40 years and finally found her, and they married. Both of them had been married before and already had children with other people. He never gave up the possibility of at least getting to see that person again. We shouldn't either. I've been a pastor for 50 years, and there have been churches that did the same thing, Baptist churches as well as Disciples of Christ churches, as well as Presbyterian churches, that said, you know, so-and-so hadn't been here in forever. Let's just take them off the rolls. You know, we're too easy to kill people. For people who believe in God, we sure kill people often. Because when you take somebody off the rolls, nobody's ever going to contact them again. You leave them on the rolls. Doesn't matter if the rolls are bigger or fuller than our membership is. Those are people, and people are loved by God. And of all things, the New Testament church should be graceful in giving them opportunity. I voted a strong no yesterday when they voted to do that. I said no loud and strong, enough that people took up and took notice. There's only me and one other guy in the whole place that voted no, but we voted no loud and strong. And when they asked, you know, Jimmy, I noticed that, boy, you were against that. Yeah, I'm against killing people. This might be my response. You Presbyterians murder people too quick because you want to just take them off the rolls. And I said, and you, when you do that and you take them off the rolls of Presbyterian, you see, it's different from a church membership. Presbyterian ministers, I'm not sure if it's true for Disciples of Christ. I'm not sure about that. But we can't be members of the church. We're members of the presbytery. My church membership is still at Second Baptist Church of Odessa. I'm proud of that because I never moved it. But I joined a presbytery. But those that are blue blood Presbyterians, see, they accepted my ordination. But the blue blood Presbyterians, when they take them off that list of presbytery, they remove their ordination. They are no longer an ordained minister. And they're no longer a member anywhere of anything. Isn't that terrible? You and I are designed to let grace come primary. We let the glory of God. Sure, there needs to be order to things. There need to be rules. Believe me, I believe that there need to be rules. But there are always exceptions to the rule. And the rule shouldn't be number one. The grace of God should be number one. Maybe we'll learn that in our meeting today when we talk about being the elders and deacons. I don't know. We live in a world, but we're not of it, the Bible says. By his armor, our character, we are defended from the world, and we live to glorify him by crucifying ourselves and becoming that new creature. One last passage before we dismiss and head over to eat, so we get plenty to eat before we have to meet. Paul's charge to Timothy, 1 Timothy chapter 6, beginning in verse 11. But you, man of God, flee from all this. Pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, endurance, gentleness, fight the good fight of the faith. Take hold of the eternal life to which you were called when you made your good confession in the presence of many witnesses. In the sight of God who gives life to everything, and of Christ Jesus who, while testifying before Pontius Pilate, made the good confession, I charge you to keep this command without spot or blame until the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ, which God will bring about in his own time. God, the blessed and the only ruler, the King of kings, the Lord of lords, who alone is immortal and who lives in unapproachable light, whom no one has seen or can see, to him be honor and might forevermore. Amen. Let's join into a spirit of prayer for just a moment, to give us an opportunity just to reflect upon the grace of God and us reflecting the glory of God in our lives as best we can wherever we are. And perhaps in this time of reflection, you have a decision to make. I'll be down here as the music is played, and if you want to respond, you are welcome to come and to respond as church membership, to become a Christian, or to pray about something in particular. I'll be here to meet you.
To everyone, you want to pass it on.